So we are, we're in a series called Tag, and I think this has been like one of the biggest marathon series that I've ever been in. I can't seem to get out of it, and but it's been good for me. I don't know about you. Tag is, if you're new here, we're talking about that game of tag that you played when you were a kid, maybe you still do. I play with my kids once in a while, but you run and you try to tag somebody, and we're not really talking about physically tagging somebody. We're talking about relationally tagging someone. So over the last, I think, about 100 weeks now, I don't know how long it's gone, but we've kind of funneled this thing down. I mean, we're almost on our next outreach right now, Rake and Bake, and we started this when we did Spray and Pray, when we were talking about how we tag the world. And so we started how to tag the world, we funneled it down to how to tag one another, to how to tag your family, to how to tag yourself, and then we're on this thing called tagging God. How do you reach out and touch God? And I wanted to just do that as kind of a one-time thing with three parts to it. And it's kind of become more of a worship series now. So anyway, if you would continue to focus with me here as we go to the next point here. Okay, so tagging God, when we talk about reaching out and tagging God, really what we're talking about is that word that we call worship. And quick definition, just jump back in this, about what worship is. Worship is talking about love that's expressed. Okay, so in any of our relationships, we can say that I love somebody, but really, is there much meaning behind that if there's no action behind that? And really, there's not, okay? You can say, Sean, I love you, but yet, behind his back, I'm not doing anything to help him or anything like that. And Sean would look and say, oh, he really doesn't love me. He's just saying that because that's what you're supposed to do. But if I really, truly care and love Sean, then I'm going to care for his family. I'm going to have his best interest in mind. I'm going to do things to help out Sean or whoever it is, okay? Love is an action verb. Love is something that needs to be expressed. And again, when we say we love God, then we need to express it. And that's what worship is all about. Worship is all about loving, expressing to God how much we really care about him. Now, when we establish this atmosphere, and I hope that what you were doing this morning, just a little bit ago, is you were creating this atmosphere of worship, this atmosphere of I love God. And when we establish an atmosphere of worship, whether it be in this place, or you know what, you can do it at home. You can do it in your shower. You can create an atmosphere of worship wherever you're at. You can create an atmosphere of worship in your car, believe it or not. Okay, and when we create this atmosphere of I love you, God, when we're in a time of worship, what happens is the darkness flees and the light comes. Okay, so when I was thinking about this, I was thinking, it's almost kind of like a tug of war match. So here's your life, okay, and so many times we're living our life in the flesh and we've got unrighteousness in our life, and what takes place is The satanic spirit takes over our life, and that's really what's leading our life. The darkness is what's leading our life. But when we start to enter into worship, when we open up to the light of God and we begin to express our love for God, what takes place, and we're going to look at this in a minute, is God naturally, supernaturally begins to come into our life. And when he comes into our life, the darkness cannot stay there. So when God comes, the darkness leaves. You get this? Okay, and you get this point, okay? So when you're in this place or wherever you're at and you feel the darkness of God upon your life, and I was pretty transparent with you this morning about how my morning went. There was probably some darkness upon that morning because I was kind of in the flesh, kind of upset, and I'm running behind, that kind of thing. And I've got to make a choice that I can allow this to overtake my life, or I can choose to worship. And as I worship, that darkness is going to flee. So where is your life right now? Is the darkness here? Is it on your life? Or are you pushing that away and allowing the presence of God, the manifest presence of God, to come upon your life? And that's how that whole thing works, that in an atmosphere of worship, that's when God comes upon your life. An atmosphere of God is irresistible, or an atmosphere of worship, let me say that, is irresistible to God. Okay? When we're looking at our church, at Lifehouse Church, I want this church to be irresistible. Okay, now, we might look at that and go, you're talking about irresistible to people that people just can't stay away? Yeah, that's part of it. But really, you know what we want? We want this church to be irresistible to God. That God sees this church and says, I can't help but stay away or not come to that church. When those people are together, there's something that's taking place that God looks at and says, I've got to be there. John 4:23 talked about this last time. He says, but the hour is coming and it's now, and now is when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. So again, it's not worshiping out of the flesh. Out of the flesh this morning, I was not going to get into worship. Out of my flesh, I was not very happy this morning. And I've got to choose to say, I'm going to take that flesh, put it on the side, and I'm going to allow my spirit to be the thing that runs my life. So I'm going to worship the Father in spirit, and I'm going to worship it in truth. That I'm going to come before God without pride and say, God, in all my humility, God, you, God, are the one that's in control. And when we worship him this way, it says, for the Father is seeking such to worship him. I probably say this every week, but again, does God lie? Okay, so if God says there, that's what he's seeking for, is a people that will worship him in spirit and truth. When you worship him that way, he's seeking for that. So if he's seeking for that, does that mean that he's going to come into this place when there's some people that are worshiping him that way? Yeah. Worship, and don't get this analogy wrong when I say this, because you can kind of take this the wrong way, but worship to God, when as I was kind of thinking about this, is a lot like, you know, in the summertime when you got those moths and millers flying all over, okay, and it's dark out, and you flip the light on, what happens? They all go to the light, okay? And again, don't take this wrong, but I really look that God is the same way. When that light of worship comes on, it's almost like God can't resist it. You know, the millers, moths, they're kind of stupid, aren't they? I mean, you can have one of those bug zappers, and the miller's flying around, that light's on, and he's seeing his buddy get zapped, and there's another, oh, Bill, oh, no, oh, Henry, oh, no, you know, and he's looking at his friends going, oh, but he can't stop. He's like, I can't stop. I just seen them, you know. And I'm not saying that God gets electrocuted in our worship. Okay, but what I'm saying is, it's kind of like that. That God, he's seeking that. It draws his presence near that when he sees worship going on. And again, I don't know how that all works with how he is. And I know I'm kind of making God into more of a human type thing, but it's almost like he's just looking over the earth and just going, oh, there's some worship. And yes, and he's there. And that's what it says here in James chapter 4, verse 8. It says, hey, draw near to God, and I hope that's what you're doing today. And when you draw near to God, that he will. It doesn't say he'll think about. It doesn't say, maybe he'll kind of look it over, and if he feels good, maybe he'll go there. It says, no, he will draw near to you. You are an irresistible thing to him in the backdrop of worship. Kind of put... I was thinking about that, kind of the mirror analogy. You know, when you look at yourself in the mirror from a long distance away, oops, you're kind of far away from it, but yet the closer you come, the closer your image comes. And really, I look at worship the same way, that the more you draw near to God, the more he's coming to you. Okay, and when you finally get in that place where it's authentic worship, you're worshiping him in spirit and truth, God is in your midst. He's looking at you. He's watching you. He wants to bless you. He's listening to your cries, but it all comes when we are in the backdrop of worship. So when we choose to worship God and in spirit and truth, we become a true worshiper and the manifest presence of God comes upon us. We're talking about there's three things that normally happens, and you can see them up on the board right now. Number one, we talked about this last week, that God will enable us to triumph. And we looked at that last week to where Moses and Israel were fighting the Amalekites. And he went and he stood up on that mountain, he raised his hands. And what was he doing when he was raising up his hands? He was worshiping God. And as he was worshiping God and creating this backdrop of atmosphere of worship to God, what was taking place is the victory, the triumph was taking place in the atmosphere of worship. We looked last week at Elijah. Elijah reestablished worship in Israel, and as soon as he reestablished that altar of God and true worship began taking place, what took place was the prophets of Baal were defeated. Triumph game. Jehoshaphat, he saw these different countries coming to attack him. God, what do I do? And God says, you don't need to do anything. The only thing you need to do is set up your army and start to worship. And he says, the battle is mine. You won't even have to fight it. All that you need to do is begin to worship. And in that atmosphere of worship, that's when I'm going to bring the triumph victory to your life. We also looked at Daniel 10. Daniel 10, that there is this need that Daniel had for victory in his mind. He had saw this vision and he needed something. And when he began to pray to worship God, it says at that point, that's when God looked at him and says, angels, go relieve him. There is something that took place when God saw worship going on within Daniel's life. He released that. And that's the same thing that will happen to your life. When you choose to worship, that does something in the heavenly. That is part of the weapons of our warfare in the spiritual realm is the weapon of worship. When we begin to worship, that's when things are let loose in the heavenly realm. So that's what we talked about last week, that God, in the midst of God's presence, that, and again, we're talking about tag here, the T is that God will triumph, okay? So we're going on to the letter A today, okay? So we're going to take a look at this, that God will exhibit his creative authority in the background of worship, okay? So what I want you to take a look at today is a foundational scripture found in the book of Job. All right, now, I know most of us know the story of Job. Job truly was a righteous man. He was, even in God's eyes, that the story goes that Satan was going to and fro, and God says, you're considering Job, aren't you, my servant? He said, yeah, I kind of am. He said, he's kind of a righteous guy, isn't he? He said, yeah, he is. He said, okay, I'll tell you what, I'll allow you to test him. He said, you can do anything you want to him, except I don't want you to take his life. Okay, so this is what happens, okay? And you probably know the story of Job. He basically lost everything. He lost his job, his career, his farm, his livestock, his family, his house, his health. He had lost everything. And what takes place is then he has three friends that come up to give him so-called counsel, what's going on in his life. And the first two come up and they accuse him of different things. And Job, he's not really buying it. But then the last guy comes up, Elihu. How would you like to have that name? Elihu. All right. Well, that's what this guy's name is. Third friend, Elihu, comes up. And he reveals why he's being tested. Okay, so if you're wondering, why did God allow Job to be tested like he did? And some people go, nobody knows. Yeah, it's written right in scripture why he was tested. Job 32:1 says, so these three men ceased answering, and here's the reason why. Because he, talking about Job, was righteous in his own eyes. He was righteous, but yet he was righteous in his own eyes. He had pride, okay? Job was a godly man with self-righteousness. God, listen to me, God will not display his authority, his creative authority in the midst of man's pride. Just won't. Worship only takes place in the midst of humility and when we recognize that God is completely in control and we begin to recognize that no one is self-righteous, not even one is what the Bible says, that the only person that deserves the tag of righteous is God himself. When we start to get into that mindset, that's when humility comes on and that's when true worship begins. But that's not what was going on with Job. Yeah, Job was righteous. He was doing a lot of the godly things, but yet he was looking at his life saying, I have no fault within me. Well, Elihu points out these issues here in verse 33. Says, surely you have spoken in my hearing, and I have heard the sound of your words, saying, I am pure, without transgression. I am innocent, and there is no iniquity in me. And then Elihu answers him in verse 12 and says, "Look, in this you are, or look, in this you are not righteous. I will answer you, for God is greater than man. Why do you contend with him?" So he answers him here and tells him this is what's going on. And Job really doesn't buy it. So God says, "Okay, Elihu, get out of here. Okay, I'll handle this." So God shows up and says, "Okay, let me take my turn, Job, because you're just not getting what's going on here." So God speaks himself to Job in order to bring humility, in order that Job can finally worship in spirit and in truth. And only in spirit and in truth, when we worship him that way, can we create a true atmosphere of worship. And only in the true atmosphere of worship will God begin to creatively move with his authority in your life. And that's what he was doing here with Job. So he goes here in verse 38, and this is where God takes off talking to Job. And this is the foundation that I want you to see here. So it says, "Then the Lord answered Job from the whirlwind." Verse 2, he says, "Who is that? Who is this that questions my wisdom with such ignorant words?" If God said that to you, would he get your attention? He wouldn't mind. "Job, who do you think you are? You come before me and you start to question my motives here?" And that's what he's saying to Job. And Job's like, okay. And then he goes on and says something even more. He says, "Brace yourself." Okay, when God says brace yourself, that's pretty serious. "Brace yourself like a man, because I have some questions for you." By the way, if God ever has questions for you, God is not looking for an answer. Okay, God doesn't need your wisdom. God isn't going, "Man, I just can't figure this problem out. Can you help me here?" There's a reason why God asks you questions. Has God ever asked you questions? He asks me questions a lot. You know, when I try to give him an answer, he goes, "No, you're missing the point. I'm not giving you the questions because I need your wisdom. I'm giving you the questions because I need you to reflect." And that's what he says here to Job. He says, "Brace yourself, because I have some questions for you and you must answer them." And then he goes on here and says, "Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Tell me." And he's kind of mocking him right now. Going, "Tell me, where were you? Do you know?" He goes on here in the next verse, he says, "Who determined its dimensions and stretched out surveying line?" And this is what I want you to see here as we move forward in this talk here. It says, "What supports its foundations?" And he says, "Who," okay, meaning God, "who laid its cornerstones?" Okay, so he's trying to get Job to see this whole idea of creation. Now, what was going on in the midst of this creation? As, okay, so he's laying the cornerstones, "as the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy." Not only here was he humbling Job here by giving a reproach to Job, saying, "Who are you to question me?" But really what he's doing here, and I hope you guys see this, he was giving Job and he was giving us an amazing picture about what was taking place during creation. God was telling Job the details of creation. See, he was saying, "Listen, when I'm stretching out the universe, when I was placing the universe in place," he's saying, "when I made the sun a perfect 10,000 degrees at the surface, and then I took the sun and I put it at 90 million miles away from the earth, whatever exactly it is, okay? By the way, get this, okay? This world, this universe is so specifically fine-tuned to sustain your life that if you knew the probability that would take for you to be breathing right now, you would be absolutely amazed. And these people that come up with these ideas as there's these alien creatures running all over the universe, you don't understand. I mean, and let me say, you're ignorant. And I'm not saying that in a slang way by trying to slam you. I'm just saying that you don't know the facts. What it takes in order to sustain life just on this earth is absolutely amazing. And let me just say, in a math sense, it's basically impossible from an improbability standpoint. It is. Study it sometime. You'd be amazed. So he places the earth, I think I had it in my notes, 91 miles away from the earth, 10,000 degrees on its surface, places it so the exact radiation the exact atmosphere that's needed, the exact heat that's needed would come upon this earth. And then he takes this earth and he puts this big ball of mud in place and then he tilts it at a 23 degree perfect angle. Couldn't have been at 24, couldn't have been at 25, had to be exactly at 23 in order to sustain life. He says, then I put the earth there in that place. And I put the moon there in that place. And I put it exactly in the galaxy where it needed to be in order to sustain life. Check out this little rendition here. This is where Earth is at, about right in this place right here. As we see these bands from the Milky Way galaxy, or the Milky Way, from our galaxy here, the Milky Way, and these bands here, we are placed in a place that is not in one of these bands. If we were in one of these bands, we couldn't survive. The sun is close to one of these bands. The earth is kind of in the mix of one of the darkness. That's one reason we can survive. We are placed in such a place that we are far enough away from this black hole that's right here that it doesn't affect us like it would if even if we were a degree closer. Okay, and by the way, the reason that we can see the stars, that we can see the glory of God like what we can on earth, is because God has placed us in an amazing place right here. If we were anywhere closer, there would be such a haze. And matter of fact, there would be all kinds of comets, and asteroids and all kinds of things going on that we would be bombarded. But yet, even if we weren't, we couldn't even see the glory of God. We couldn't even see the stars if we were put in a separate place, even within our own galaxy. And God is looking at Job saying, when I stretched out the heavens, when I put the earth in that exact place, and then he not only did he put it in the exact place, but then he went, and he pushed the earth, and he said, and then it's going to rotate at 1,000 miles per hour around this ginormous star. And he says, not only is he going to do that, but watch this. And he made it rotate, and matter of fact, no, I'm sorry, I get that mixed up. 66,000 miles is what we're rotating at, but yet he spins the earth at 1,000 miles per hour, around it and around and around it goes, in order that it can sustain life. And he looked at Job and he says, I did all that, where were you? Where were you when I fine-tuned the universe so that you could even have life? And he looked at Job and he says, you know what, Job? You weren't even a blip on the radar for existence at that point. Who are you to question me? But he says, not only that, but guess what? Guess who was there when I was doing all of this? He says, you know who was there? The angels were there, and guess what the angels were doing? In the backdrop of my creation, my creative authority, the morning stars were singing together, and all the angels were shouting. So again, get this picture in the atmosphere that God is demonstrating here, saying, I was doing the creation in that atmosphere. What was taking place in my authority, my creative authority, was there was worship going on. Okay, so he's saying this. He's saying, when I did this, okay, go to the next one. When I created this, when I created the sun right here, you guys are getting ahead of me. You're ruining my example here. This is what's going on. He does the sun, and the angels did. Okay? I know this is really cheesy. Then he said, whoa, they're worshiping. He said, why don't we do this? And the earth came. But then he looked and the angels are going, whoa, look at that. Look what God did. And they're making all this noise. And God's going, I love this worship. Why don't I do this? And then he says, let there be water. Let there be life. Let there be vegetations. And the angels went, whoa, awesome. And then he says, not only that, but let's do this. And then there was animals. There's all kinds of things that was taking place in the backdrop of worship of what was going on. And then to finish it off, he said, oh, you think that's good? You think that's making you sing? Well, how about this? Okay, and he created you and me, and the angels went, whoa, hallelujah. They were freaking out, and God says, not only was that good, but man, that is very good, okay? Do you see what's going on here? This is what's taking place when God was unleashing his creative authority upon this earth. There was worship going on. And this is a principle. You've got to understand that, yeah, it was there at the beginning of creation, but guess what? This pattern is still here today. God unleashes his creative authority in the backdrop of a worship atmosphere. When we begin to paint that worship backdrop, and God sees that, he starts coming, and he can't resist. He's like, look, they're worshiping me. They're singing to me. They're giving thanks to me, okay? And as we're painting that backdrop, God says, I've got to go manifest myself in that place. And that, again, when he unleashes his creative authority in your life. Just like he did at creation, that's how he does things. That's his pattern. That's why worship is so important. So if you want God to unleash that in your life, his creative authority. Anybody need that in your life right now? If you do, then let me say this. Begin to paint the backdrop of worship in your life. Because God creates miracles when he sees worship. Because guess what? He's attracted to that. That's what he's attracted to. John 4:23 again says, for the Father is seeking such to worship him. He's looking. Who's going to do it? Who's going to worship? Because my presence is going to go there. And I'm not just talking about his omnipresence that we have all the time. I'm talking about his manifest presence. He's saying, I want to manifest myself somewhere, but I do that in the backdrop of worship. That's what he's seeking for. As I was thinking about this, I was thinking, and maybe I'm looking again too much of God being kind of a human, but it's almost like that's what stirs up his energy. It's almost like that's kind of the thing that motivates him. And I'm not saying that God isn't already self-motivated. It's kind of like in cars. I'm not a big car person or whatever. My dad is, and drag races all the time. But you can have a finely tuned engine in drag race and have a fast car. But there's a little bottle that you can buy that hook up to your carburetor called nitrous oxide, okay? I think that's what it's called. And you can be going fast and then flip that switch and it just turns on. And again, forgive me if I'm just reading too much of the human side of God into this, but it's almost like that's what takes place, that God is going throughout the universe doing amazing things, but then it's like when he sees worship, he's like, oh, yes! And it's like that just motivates him to go, I've got to be with those people. I've got to manifest myself because that's what I'm seeking for. I'm looking, I'm seeking, I'm drawing myself near to those people that are drawing near to me. Let me show you this in scripture here. In Daniel chapter 3, you guys are going to know this story probably, but it's still a good review. Nebuchadnezzar, he's this prideful king of Babylon. He creates this great image and he looks at everybody in his country and he says, I want everybody to worship this image. And of course, in that land was the exiles that came from Israel. They were brought there. They were put in slavery. And there's four, but this story is about three of them. They're Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And that was their Babylonian names. Their Hebrew names were Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. But Nebuchadnezzar heard that they aren't going to bow down to this idol. So he calls and says, I want them bound up. And he's furious and he says, you guys know this. You guys knew this when you were kids from this story. I want them thrown in that fiery furnace. So the story goes that he cranked up this furnace so high that even the guards that had bound him to throw them in there, once they opened up that furnace, however they did that, it was so hot it just consumed them. Okay, and the point is this, that there is no way that they were going to be saved without a miracle. And get this, there is no way they were going to be saved unless the presence of God showed up in the midst of that trial. Daniel 3 verse 24 talks about this. It says, then the king Nebuchadnezzar was astonished. This is after he threw them in the fiery furnace and he looks in and they weren't being consumed. And Nebuchadnezzar was astonished and he rose in haste and spoke, saying to his counselors, did we not cast three men bound into the midst of the fire? And they answered the king and said, true, O king, yeah, we threw three in. And then he goes on and he says, well, look, there's not three in there anymore. I see four men loose walking in the midst of the fire and they are not hurt. And the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. Now get this, okay? This is in the background of worship that this took place. I'm kind of lost my place here. Where am I at here? Can you say awkward? Okay, awkward, okay. In the midst of this tragedy, what we see here is the presence of God drew near. And when the presence of God drew near, God unleashed his creative authority upon that fiery furnace to the point where it says that not one hair upon their head was singed. Is that creative authority to you? That God can show up in the midst of a fiery furnace and somehow defy the laws of combustion? I don't know if that's even a law or whatever. I'm not a science guy, but somehow he looked at the flames and looked at the heat and said, stand back, stand back, stand back. And not a hair on their head was singed. That is some amazing creative authority that's going on in the midst of that fiery furnace. Now check this out, okay? This is why I believe that it took place. It's because what we're talking about today, that God does these things in the midst of a backdrop of worship. In go on to the next scripture here. Verse 328 says, Nebuchadnezzar spoke saying, blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who sent his angels and delivered his servants who trusted in him, and they have frustrated the king's word. Now check this out. Okay, it says, and they yielded their bodies. Now stop right there a minute. Do you remember what Romans 12:1 says? Romans 12:1 says, to offer your bodies or to yield up your bodies as a living sacrifice that's holy and pleasing to God. And then he says, this is your true act of worship. So right here we have them in this fiery furnace, and it says that this is what Nebuchadnezzar took from this. He said, you yielded up your bodies. Well, what's that all about? They were worshiping God. In the midst of that trial, somehow they found the way to worship God. Then he backs this up by saying, they should not serve nor worship any gods except their own God. So obviously they were worshiping their own God. They were yielding their lives up saying, here it is, God, I'm giving my life up for you. Do what you need with it, God. So here's a reflection question I want you to think about for just a moment. Put yourself, is everybody listening? Put yourself in the place of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Okay, be Shadrach for a minute, okay? Maybe somebody wants to be Abednego. I don't care, whatever you want to be, okay? Be one of the three. You're in a foreign land, so you're a slave. They were probably actually made into eunuchs. I hate to say that, but they probably were. Okay, so I'd have been upset about that anyway. And we'll leave it at that, okay? Now they're said that we've got to worship this golden statue. No, I'm not going to do that. So they're ticked off about that. So now the king grabs you and screaming at you, probably beat you, and then bounds you up, and then they start walking you towards a fiery furnace. You see that fiery furnace coming. Probably the mob mentality takes over, and everybody in the land that was on the side of the idolatry was probably screaming at them, you losers! Why don't you join in with our society here? And they're probably hitting them, smacking them, spitting on them. So here is this prey to these three that used to be men of Israel that could worship their God. They're bound now, walking towards this fiery furnace, enslaved by this foreign, prideful king, being yelled at by everybody. Let me just ask you, would you feel like worshiping God at that point? I wouldn't. I just know me, and I know how I am, and I just sometimes get the little thing. I'm like, come on, God, good grief. You know, and I started crying and having this whole pity party. Can you imagine that going on? My point is this. Worship isn't only when you feel like it. In the midst of their storms here, in the midst of every one of our storms here, when we feel like all hell is breaking loose in our life, and so many times it is, and in this story, literally hell was broken loose in that pit. The last thing that's on our mind sometimes is, God, I just want to praise you and be thankful to you. But again, as I started this service off, looking at Hebrews 13, 15, this is what I want you to take from this. It says, therefore, by him, let us continually offer up the sacrifice of praise to God, that is our fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. Continually. That we shouldn't stop. Even in our trials, he says here, listen, this is part of your spiritual weapon or weaponry. Okay, when you are going through the trial, even though you don't feel like it, that we are to stop and give a sacrifice of praise. And again, as I said before, what is a sacrifice? A sacrifice is when you give something when your flesh really doesn't want you to give it, but you still give it anyway. And I assure you, that's what's going on here. Because these people, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, were no different than us. And they were being marched to their death, but yet they gave a sacrifice of praise. And in the midst of this backdrop, they painted of worship. As that was the atmosphere that was around them, that's when the manifest presence of God showed up in their life. And that's when the miracle took place. One other context, and then we'll close here. Anybody know Acts 16? Paul and Silas? Paul and Silas, they were out on the evangelism trail. And they cast a demon out of this girl, and the crowd got all ticked off about it because their miracle worker had been taken away from them now. And they were upset. The society was upset at them. So they grabbed Paul, they grabbed Silas, and they beat them mercifully. Okay, they beat them so bad they were unconscious. They shackled them up, they took them, and they put them in the middle dungeon. Probably one reason why prisoners were put in the middle dungeon is because they were going to be executed the next day. So Paul and Silas wake up after they had just been beaten. They're in stocks, looking around. They're probably cold. I mean, the prisons back then were not like the country clubs that we have today. And I'm not saying that I want to ever go to one, but they didn't have cable TV. They didn't have a vending machine that they could go to. They didn't have recreation time. They didn't have time that they could go play cards with their friends. Okay, the things that we allow in the prisons now, they didn't have that kind of stuff. They were in this middle dungeon. Matter of fact, when we're in Israel, we got a chance to go in one. Okay, and there was probably raw sewage going through there. It was probably freezing cold. They were beaten up. They were bleeding. Probably rats around. And they knew that they were going to probably be executed. Now let me ask you again, put yourself in their place. You feel like worshiping right now? You feel like painting that great picture of God, saying, thank you, God, for what is going on? Probably not. But see, this is where Paul and Silas said, we've got to stick to our spiritual discipline. And we've got to understand the weapons of our warfare. And we've got to create and we've got to begin to paint this backdrop of worship. Acts 16, verse 25 says this. Around midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. And the other prisoners were listening. So again, there was this great atmosphere of worship that they had just created. What took place when that atmosphere of worship was created? Suddenly there was a massive earthquake and the prisons were shaken to its foundation and all the doors immediately flew open and the chains of every prisoner fell off. So again, the last thing that you'd be thinking about in that situation is, you know what, I just need to worship God. But again, it comes back to this, folks, spiritual discipline. You've got to be disciplined because there is going to be trials in your life. And what are you going to do when those trials take place? As I was thinking about this, and this isn't even in my notes, but I was thinking about football. I love sports. And, you know, back in the Huskers' heyday, which they're trying to get back to now, they haven't accomplished that yet, even though they pulled it out yesterday. But the fact is this, that in the heyday, they could do all kinds of plays to where there'd be trick plays and, you know, they would do that drop back option thing and throw the pass and or throw the quarterback reverse pass or whatever you call those things. Those kind of nifty things that we all go, oh, that was a great play. Okay, but you know what? When things start going bad, you know what they would go back to? Let's just run the trap. Just run up the middle. Let's just keep pounding them, keep pounding them. Wait, you're behind by 14 points. We're going to go back to our disciplines. We're just going to pound. That's what we do. Boom, boom, boom. And pretty soon, pew. Okay, the fullback goes and scores a touchdown and you start winning the game. But the point is this, okay? Even when things don't seem like they're going the right direction, that's when you've got to fall back on your discipline. Whether you feel like it or not, you go back to, you know what? This is our game plan. This is what God said to do. And when you get in the midst of your trials, you've got to go back to your discipline and say, you know what, God? I really don't feel like it. But in order that I can be set free, in order for your presence to come, I've got to begin to paint that backdrop of worship. And when I paint that backdrop of worship, your promise is, God, that you're going to come. Guess what, folks? You're going to have trials. Every one of us had a lot of trials in the past, and I hate to paint a bad picture for you like some churches try to do and say, hey, come to Christ and everything's going to be great. Guess what? It's not. You are still going to have trials. Matter of fact, it says, Jesus said, these are red letters, John 16:33. These things I have spoken to you that you may have peace. Okay, so you can have peace in the midst of your trials, but it says, in the world, you will have tribulation. And the way this world is going, Christians, there is going to be tribulation. So you better learn how to fight against this tribulation in your life. He has given us weapons of warfare. And in the midst of your trials, the way that the miracle is going to take place in your life, it's going to be released in the backdrop of worship. That's when his creative authority is going to come. But yeah, Brad, I'm unemployed. I don't care. Quit worrying. Worship. But I've just been given this disease and I'm going to be really sad. I don't care, God would say. Quit worrying and just worship. But the wrong person got elected to our country. I don't care. It doesn't matter whether Hillary or Donald Trump is your president. I am in control. Quit worrying and just worship. Amen. Worship. Because there's peace when the presence of God comes into your life. 1 Thessalonians 5:18. In everything. Some translations say, in all things. That means the good, the bad, the ugly. What are we supposed to do in the good, the bad, the ugly? Give thanks, for this is the will. This is the will of God in Christ Jesus for every single person here. You're going to have trials in life. And this is the perspective that I want you to take from this. If you can just get yourself out of your flesh, to take that flesh, put it off of you, move into your spirit, and begin to paint the backdrop of worship when trials are going on in your life. The word says God promises that he will take notice because he seeks for that. And his pattern from the very beginning, and by the way, still going on today, as I said before, is he unleashes his creative authority during the backdrop of praise and worship. Listen, everyone, the more you need God to release his power in your life, the more you need to paint the picture of backdrop in your life. That is your weapon of warfare. When you worship, it gets the attention of God, and it's almost as if God looks down, and as he's looking around the world, he sees that worship. He said, angels, shh, be quiet, be quiet. They're calling. Angels, we got to go. They're calling. And it's almost like that's when God goes in that manifest presence and those angels are released and it comes down upon your life in the backdrop of worship. That's when it takes place. So again, we've looked at 2 points now. When we worship God, when he manifests his presence, number one, God will give you the triumph. Number two, God will exhibit his creative authority in worship. And if you come next week, you'll finally get the conclusion of this, that God will extend his grace during worship. Amen? Why don't you stand up with me? Let's pray. Hallelujah, Lord. We stand before you right now. And every one of us, God, has trials going on in our life. I know most people in this congregation, God, and I know what's going on in their life, and I know every one of us need your manifest presence to draw near to us. But God, we have seen today through your word. I have seen, and this message is probably for me, God, more than probably for anybody. And God, I needed this message this morning. In my flesh, and probably so many else here, the flesh was trying to lead my life this morning, God. And I thank you for your word, God, that reminded me if I can just take that off and worship you in spirit and truth, and I can begin to create that backdrop of worship, that's when you're gonna unleash your creative authority. I pray, God, for everybody's life here. I pray, God, that this word will dig deep into the heart of every single person here. God, this is probably the nuclear weapon of our warfare in the spiritual realm, is our obedience to worship you. And God, when we worship you, the darkness, the satanic forces will flee, and God, your presence will come. And God, we thank you. In the midst of that, that's when the miracles take place. I pray, God, that every single person here would receive that miracle as they begin to worship you in spirit and truth. In Jesus' name, amen.